All right. Hi, guys. Welcome to this Hangout, connecting devices to the cloud using Zigbee. So let's get started. On the first slide here, we would like to see what the difference between Zigbee and XBee is. So Zigbee is basically a specification for a high-level communication protocol that is used to create personal area networks. These are built on small, low-power digital radios. It is based on the IEEE standard 802.15.4. Because these devices are low-powered, the transmission distance varies from 10 to 100 meters, depending upon the line of sight and the various other factors that are placed over there. However, if there is a Zigbee device that is outside this radius, then you can definitely form a mesh network, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So these devices, which are in between the first device and the last device, would relay the message, and you can get the message across to the end. Zigbee is typically used in a low data rate application that require long battery life and a secure network. It was conceived in 1998 and standardized in 2003, and thus the Zigbee Alliance was formed. Let's talk a little bit about XBees. XBees are here on the right hand side. These are XBee modules that are based on the Zigbee protocol, and they are made by Digi, and these are easily available, and they have a nice software. Digi has released its own software called XCTU to configure these, so it becomes really easy to play with these. So let's understand a few things about why to use a Zigbee module or a Zigbee protocol. Why not just use Bluetooth or Wi-Fi instead? So the main reason is Zigbee was basically designed from ground up to enable wireless network of things. That's why a few key points that were always kept in mind while designing this was, first was low cost. So the sensors and that are deployed in the field are pretty low cost, and thus you cannot spend a lot of money on networking components. So low cost was one key component. Second was low power, because some of these devices were battery operated. The battery should typically last at least a year or two minimum. So low power was another constraint. The third point in designing Zigbee was high reliability. So low touch or no human intervention was a criteria for this. And the last point being scalability, because there could be a huge network of these sensors. The communication protocol should be highly scalable, and that was a key thing that was kept in mind. So let's just compare to other communication protocols like Bluetooth or Wi-Fi for that matter, and why Zigbee is better for such a network of things application. So Bluetooth was basically designed, classic Bluetooth was basically designed as a wire replacement between your cell phones and nearby devices such as handhelds and PDAs. It does satisfy the low cost requirement, but does not do well for the other three. So you can keep a Bluetooth device maybe for 2 or 3 weeks, but definitely for months and years it was not possible without a battery recharge. Also, a human intervention was a part of keeping it into the keeping the Bluetooth device in the loop, which has been taken care of by Bluetooth low energy, but still something like a mesh network and all these are at very beta stage. And third, Bluetooth was designed to handle around 7 or 8 devices, and once the number of devices go up, even on a Wi-Fi network, the network typically becomes substantially slow. So that was one more reason that ZigBee is preferred. Let's understand a few things about the ZigBee protocol. In the ZigBee protocol, it has support for multiple network topologies, such as point-to-point, point-to-multipoint, and mesh networks. We'll talk in detail about all these in a bit. Another key factor is a low duty cycle, which provides a long battery life, which is very critical in terms of the network devices that go in the field. Then there is a low latency, and because I mentioned earlier, it is scalable. So one ZigBee network can support up to 65,000 nodes. So that's quite a lot of devices on one network. It also has other features like 128 AES encryption and secure data connections. It also has collision avoidance, retries, and acknowledgement. So we'll talk more about this when we talk about the various AT mode and API mode networks in ZigBee. So let's look at some of the commercially available system on chip ZigBee ICs. Texas Instruments, Silicon Labs, Marvel, Freescale, NXP, Atmel, T-Link. These are different ICs that you can get that have a ZigBee added onto them, and you can use them. Let's move on. In this hangout, I would specifically like to talk about the XB that is made by Digi, just because I've been working on it, and I have a few demos also later on to show. So there is a really nice guide that is in this link over here that has been made by SparkFun that tells you what kind of XB you should buy, or if you want to get started with it. So typically the Series 1, then ZNet 2.5, which was formerly known as Series 2, and then there is ZB. We'll just talk about the first three today. So S1 are the easiest to get started with because they would work right out of the box as you get them. If you plug them into XCTU, and you just have to configure the destination low and high addresses of the two XBs, and they'll start talking to each other. The Series 1 only supports point-to-point or star topology. So in terms of networking, it does not have a lot of advanced features. That is where Series 2 comes in, where you can have a router, a coordinator, and an endpoint, and all of these would be in a mesh network. Endpoints are typically used for battery, where power utilization is a key factor. So end devices like remotes and stuff would be configured to be as an endpoint, and others would be a router or cord. The router would be the central one, and then a coordinator will relay those messages ahead. ZB is a better version of Series 2, where you also have a microcontroller on the XBN, which is programmable. So that gives you a lot of flexibility. So you wouldn't have to have a microcontroller and a communication model. ZB would do both in one for you. Let's look at this other link over here that tells you the major differences between Series 1 and Series 2. There are range issues, range differences, 100, 133 feet. And as you go to the Pro module, then you would get a better range. A key fact to note over here is Series 1 and Series 2 work on different protocols. Therefore, they would not be able to communicate with each other. So if you have a Series 1 network, then a Series 2 node cannot be added into it. And pretty much, I think apart from that, there are a few technical specific tech specs that are different, but it is pretty much that is pretty much about it. All right. So next, let's. I had those screenshots. Okay. I will be skipping over this part about adding an XB and configuring it. But I'll just briefly tell you what are the different ways you can use the XCTU software that is provided by Digi. Then instead of that, if you want to go from the terminal, then you can use screen and do a sudo screen/dev/tty or whatever your port number is, followed by your baud rate, and it would log you directly into a terminal session with your XB, where you can send in AT commands or API commands, whatever your. Also, on a Windows machine, you can log in to this using PuTTY. You can open up a serial communication between the computer and the XB modules. I wanted to talk about AT mode versus an API mode, and I have a screenshot over here which will help us understand the difference. So, for those who are familiar with TCP and UDP packet, I can relate AT and API with that. AT could be considered as a UDP packet, and API is more of a TCP connection. So I have a screenshot where I have configured one device to be a coordinator, another to be a router, and the last one as the end device. So whenever there is a transmit request sent from the coordinator, you see that the router receives it, the end device receives it, and there's also a transmit status that is gotten back on the coordinator, which tells us that there is the packet has been received by this. So this happens in case of an API mode. In AT mode, it is just like throwing a bottle. Well, it's much more accurate than that, but it's like throwing a bottle into the ocean and with a message onto it, and you expect it to reach the other side of the globe and someone to get it. But there's no actual confirmation from the other side that the packet has been received. Next, there's the point-to-point versus mesh. So here, if you see, this is your central node in the star, and all these devices have a one-way connection with the central node. The broadcast or the destination high address of this would be set to FFFF, and all these others would be zeros. So they know that it is this one would be a central node, and everything that your end devices send would they know that this is the target. In case of a mesh network, it becomes a little bit different. So all these devices form a mesh. And let's say if I have to send something from the coordinator over here to the terminal end point over here. So if the range is not enough from the mesh to the end point, then this message gets sent to the nearest router, and then this router sends it to this router, and the router relays the message to the terminal. So that is the benefit of a mesh network. You can also have a cluster where there are individual star topologies, and they come together and form a cluster over here. But series 2, this is the best part about it, is you can add a mesh networking into it, which becomes really handy. Now let's look at TAR that Anuj talked about last time in his hangout. And here's something where we are using the TAR to be a bridge between your cell phones and the XB networks that are around you. So let me start that up. Okay. Okay, there seems to be some problem. I'm not able to buffer this video, but you guys can take a look at it. You guys can take a look at it afterwards. Okay, so next I wanted to give you guys a quick demo of the home automation system that I've been building, in which I've been using XBs. And now let me switch to a video over here. Stop screen sharing. Turn the camera. All right. So here's the board that I have designed, and you can see that there's a XB sitting on top of it, and there's a microcontroller over here, and these are various capacitors and triacs that do the switching of this. And this entire switchboard goes and sits behind your existing switchboard. And then there's this XB that sits on an Explorer, and it is connected to a Raspberry Pi, which is running a server. So I'll show you guys a quick demo of the app that I have made. So we have installed a switchboard like this in the office, office switchboard, and here's an app in which it shows me the map of the room. And when I click on the room, a switchboard should open. Okay, so that says it's a switchboard, and you can see behind me that the lights can be controlled from here. I'll turn them on again, and then there's one at the entrance. Okay, I can also do a master off, and that will turn all the lights in the outside section off at the same time. I can do a restore, and all of them can turn on. So that is project that I've been working on. Let me start the screen sharing over here again, and let's go back to the slides. Okay, so before we come towards the end, I wanted to share a few other links with you guys, where Thread Group is another organization that has been using Zigbee's a lot, and you can see over here that they have a lot of stuff going around with the XBs. So this is one resource that you guys should definitely look at. Other than that, there's definitely the Zigbee.org, which is a Zigbee Alliance, where a lot of these companies have made a standard, and from there it kind of becomes easy for different devices to talk to each other, because they are on the standard, and multiple companies can have different products, and they can seamlessly integrate with each other if you are a part of the Zigbee Alliance. So if you see Bosch, Control Flow, Legrand, General Life, LG, Logitech, Philips, Samsung, and Schneider, a lot of the big names are a part of this Zigbee Alliance. So whatever application that you do, if you get Zigbee certified, then you become a part of this big alliance, and then your products can work easily with these other things. So I do not see any questions throughout. Are there any questions? Let me just check that. If there are any questions, I'll take them now or wait for them. And I think we're done otherwise. All right, guys. Thank you for listening, and you have a good night.